Hello and welcome to a brand new video on our Sage Max channel. I am Michael Muller and in this video, I will show you how you can increase the strength and therefore the reliability of your zirconium oxide restorations. First, we will take a look at the scientific literature and then discuss one study in particular. Next, we will find out why the polishing of surfaces increases the strength of zirconium oxide. Finally, I would like to share two tips on handling zirconium oxide with you. Enough said, I hope you enjoy the video. It is scientifically accepted that the surface quality of zirconium oxide influences the material's strength. Numerous studies have confirmed this fact. The following slide shows a few examples of research studies that support these findings. Now, I would like to discuss a particularly interesting research report in more detail. In this investigation, both unpolished and polished zirconium oxide specimens were sent to a total of 12 different test laboratories, where they underwent strength testing. The results were subsequently evaluated and compared with each other. It was found that 11 of the 12 laboratories measured higher strength results on polished specimens. On average, a strength increase of 56% was recorded. The highest average increase in strength was 90%, which in turn means that the strength of the specimens was almost twice as high after polishing than before polishing. What can we infer from this investigation? We can conclude that the polishing of zirconium oxide surfaces has a significant influence on the strength of the material. But why is this the case? We will take a look at a simple experiment to answer this question. The blue beam represents a zirconium oxide specimen. It is supported at both ends by rollers A and B, and it is loaded at the center with forceps. This setup, incidentally, corresponds to that of a typical three-point bending test. If we look at the stress curve of the test specimen, you will see that on the side of the specimen where force is applied, compressive stress builds up, while on the opposite side, tensile stress is generated. The highest compressive stress and tensile stress values occur at the surface of the specimen. In brittle materials, such as zirconium oxide, cracks that ultimately lead to fractures form in areas where stresses are the highest. This usually occurs in superficial defects, such as corners, edges, and notches, or in internal flaws such as microcracks, pores, and other imperfections. In this video, however, I will concentrate on superficial defects exclusively since they have a decisive influence on the strength of the restoration and can be controlled manually. Where do you think the highest stress accumulates in this specimen? Exactly, in the area circled in red. This means that this notch represents the greatest weakness in this specimen, and the crack that will cause it to fracture will grow from there with very high probability. This observation is confirmed by the scanning electron micrographs of the fracture surface. They clearly show where the crack originated and how it grew within the material. Both images show that the cracks originated in large defects in particular and continued to grow from there. However, what happens when superficial flaws are removed or significantly reduced by polishing? When these surface defects are removed or reduced, more force has to be applied in order to build up the same stress concentrations and initiate a fracture. In simple terms, this means that the restoration has become stronger. How does this finding come in useful for our work? First of all, we have to find out in which areas of the bridge the highest stresses occur. In order to answer this question, we conducted a finite element analysis on a 4-unit bridge. In this test, the bridge was subjected to an average chewing force of 550 newtons, which corresponds to around 56 kilograms. The results clearly show that compressive stress builds up in occlusal areas and tensile stress at the base of the bridge. The highest stresses occurred in interdental areas in particular. As we have learned, the areas that are subjected to tensile stress are those that require the most attention with regard to superficial flaws. That's why I would now like to share two tips with you, which will help you to enhance the reliability of your bridge restorations. First, before you build up, stain, or glaze your restorations, always remove any surface defects in areas that are exposed to high tensile stress. Special attention should be paid to the interdental areas and connectors at the base. Superficial flaws can be easily removed through manual polishing. If you are interested in finding out more about high-quality ceramic polishers, take a look at our NexZR Shine polishing system. I will link a video on this topic in the video description box. Second, you should always create U-shaped interdental areas to ensure that tensile stress is evenly distributed. Interdental areas that are V-shaped could be conducive to concentrating stresses. Furthermore, do not rework the interdental areas intensively after sintering. The separation of interdental areas with a diamond cutting disc can cause local stress concentration and phase transformation, which in turn can weaken the bridge. Last but not least, I would like to show you how to polish the interdental areas of a bridge to significantly enhance the reliability of the restoration. For now, I would like to say goodbye to you. Thank you for watching. If you like this video, be sure to click the like button and subscribe to our channel. I look forward to seeing you again soon.